مهمان من رئیس کمیته پارلمانی بریتانیا برای آزادی ایران است. اعضای این کمیته که ده ها نماینده بریتانیایی از احزاب متفاوت هستند، معتقدند که نجات ایران در برقراری یک حکومت دموکراتیک و سکولار است و کلید آن هم در دست سازمان مجاهدین خلق ایران است. آنها در کمک‌های تبلیغاتی خود به مجاهدین خلق برای رسیدن به این هدف از هیچ تلاشی فروگذار نمی‌کنند. این لابی چیست و اعضای آن کیستند و چرا برای آزادی ایران آن هم به دست مجاهدین خلق چنین مصرند؟ Lord Corbett, welcome to Beavarte Diga.
Thank you.
Lord Corbett, tell me about this committee, the Parliamentary Committee for Iran Freedom. How many active members do you have?
We don't actually have members as such. We have got the support of the biggest half of backbench MPs in the House of Commons and more than 200 peers, all parties.
When you say support, what do you mean? I mean, what
well,
do they do?
Well, I mean, for example, we circulate statements of support over a peaceful solution to the massacres going on at Camp Ashraf in Iraq by the Iraqi government at the behest of the Iranians. Or we write a letter to Hillary Clinton asking her to, for America to accept that he's got some responsibilities to stop this happening.
But
we'll collect all those signatures. Yeah.
But this is recent. I mean, the committee existed for so many years.
Yes, that's
I mean,
right,
what
yes.
did you do before Camp Ashraf?
Oh, I see. Well, we took up issues to do with trying to further the cause of assisting those who want to see free and democratic change in Iran and the establishment of a secular government with the mullahs in the mosques and elected politicians in the ministries and respect for human rights and an end to the nuclear weapons development. So anything we could felt we could do to assist that, to gain support for that idea, then we did.
And you think that the committee thinks basically that the only organization that is doing that towards toppling the mullahs, as you call it, is the MEK?
Well, the PMOI, of course, is part of the National Council of Resistance, the Coalition National Council of Resistance of Iran. It's the biggest single member. And they have got a part to play in this, but only a part, because there are others in Iran. There are millions in Iran who cry freedom.
But, Lord Corbett, forgive me, many people believe, really, that it's the only organization within that National Council of Resistance. The other are individuals, and it is true that when it was formed, there were many organizations
yes.
who joined. Yeah. But gradually, every organization just backed off from the organizations. And the reason was that it was dominated by the Mujahideen, as well, dictated by the Mujahideen.
Well, I mean, that I don't know, because I'm not frankly interested in the internal workings of that organization. What I'm interested in is an organization which wants to end the appalling human rights abuses that go on are carried out by the mullahs in Iran, and those have got worse, censured by the UN 55, 56 times. That's the start of all this. We want Iranians to be part of the modern world, to be able to walk around the world with their heads high, and millions of Iranians want the same thing, and we want to do our bit to try to help bring that about.
And why do you think that the National Council of Resistance and the Mujahideen in particular are the only organization capable of achieving?
I didn't say they're the only organization.
But you support
capable.
Only them?
Yeah. No, no, because, you know, they're the ones who approached us through the National Council of Resistance of Iran. None others have done that. There are certainly the they've been in this business longer than anyone else.
But before them, Lord Corbett, there were many Iranian organizations from left and right who were opposing the Iranian government
sure.
over the years.
Yeah.
And they were struggling, they were imprisoned, they were tortured, they were executed.
Well, you've answered your own question then, haven't you?
But what I'm saying is that
the mothers made sure they didn't
Yeah, but you haven't supported
exist.
Them. You only supported
oh,
them.
Well, I was never asked to.
You mean if tomorrow some other organization come to you and says support us, you will support them?
I want to be friends with all those who want democratic, peaceful change in the establishment of a secular state in Iran. Anybody who's wants that, they're my friend, and I'm theirs.
Yeah, but recently, look over some of the Americans, for example, Lee Hamilton, who was the candidate for the presidential election in America from the Democratic Party, and also General Zinni, who was the commander of the Central Command of the United States. They actually admitted in a television interview to say that they have been paid huge sums of money by the Mujahideen to support them.
I know,
your organization being supported by the Mujahideen financially?
I know nothing about that at all. I know nothing about that.
You personally haven't been paid for your support?
No. Not at all. We don't do it for that reason. At all.
Right.
All of us are concerned about the bottom line of why we've got such tremendous support in both houses of parliament is that all of us are concerned about the appalling human rights abuses that the Mullahs carry out in Iran at the moment. That's the start of this. And the only way to stop that is to replace this religious fundamental dictatorship and have an elected, freely elected government that respects human rights, that ends the nuclear weapons program, and insists on democracy. You can sum that out as I have.
But recently, in the last 2 years after the last presidential election in Iran, there's been a huge movement inside Iran. It's called the Green Movement, which they're calling for democracy and they want to change and reform in the Iranian government. Have you supported them? Have you been to their gathering? Have you spoken there?
I can go to Iran. What do you think the Mullahs?
What I'm saying is their supporters abroad. There have been a huge number of gatherings in Western Europe, in America, in London,
I've never been invited.
Do you know why they're not invited?
You'll have to ask them. Maybe if they watch this, they'll invite me. But I think you should be careful about this because the leading members of that Green Movement were approved as candidates by the Guardian Council for the stolen elections of 2009. And they had been, in several ways, part of the ruling elite in Iran. I don't say that to condemn them, because I think they have now recognized that there's going to be no democratic change in Iran until the Mullahs are a dirty stain on the pages of Iran's history.
Yeah, but what you're saying is basically because some of the leaders of the Green Movement, you're referring to Mr. Mousavi and Mr. Karoubi.
Sure.
Okay.
If they want to change their minds because that's where public opinion is in Iran, fine. I've got no problems with that.
Yeah.
But they were approved candidates, and you can only stand for election if you're approved by the regime.
Yes.
Which is a long way short of democracy.
Yeah, but people can change.
Of course, absolutely.
The Mujahideen organization was engaged in terrorist activities. But
itself changed, yes.
Yeah. Do you personally support this movement in Iran?
Which movement, Sisna?
The Green Movement.
Yeah, I support anyone who wants democratic change in Iran. Full stop.
Okay. But despite that, when the people, supporters of the Green Movement all over the world basically gathered and in rallies and supported the Green Movement inside Iran, the MEK had their own separate kind of gathering.
They're a separate organization.
They all gathered together. That was supposed to be some sort of a unity to support the Iranian people inside the country. But the Mujahideen didn't do that.
Sure there are members of the PMY who attended those demonstrations. The interesting thing about this is that those protests started off, if you'll remember, the big demonstrations immediately after that stolen election result was, where's my vote? And it ended up with death to the religious dictatorship, which is precisely the slogan used by the PMY and the NCRI. So that changed in a sense.
Yeah.
You know, the call on the streets, and this is what provoked the appalling violence in the way the regime responded
to that. It is true.
It made Assad in Syria look like an amateur.
Yeah, it is true that the Green Movement contains all sorts of people with different views and approach.
Yes, sure.
To whether some of them who are reformists, they believe within the current system there can be some improvement and reform. There are people who have an outright overthrow of the Islamic system. There are all sorts of people there, so the slogans varies. That is true. But the thing is that it seems that the people who are supporting Green Movement, especially outside the country, they don't want the MEK to support them for some reason.
Well, that's up to them.
So that doesn't worry you that you're supporting an organization that other people, they don't want?
I would like to see the broadest possible coalition to achieve democratic change in Iran. But if they don't feel able to do that, and I mean, you tell me that they don't feel able to do that, what would happen if they came out and said, we welcome members of the PMOI and the NCRI joining our demonstrations? How are the mullahs going to react to that? How many more of them are going to be slung into prison? Held without trial. This is a real answer. Okay. So this is not a normal opposition movement in a country that understands and uses democracy. It is 10, 20 times harder in Iran to build these coalitions because the minute the mullahs spell trouble, they'll crack down on this like a ton of bricks.
Yeah, but it's not just the mullahs that they have a negative attitude towards the mujahideen.
I'm not saying that.
Many people. I mean, it's often said that the MEK has more support among the lords and MPs and senators and congressmen than people inside Iran.
How would you know how much support the PMI has got in Iran?
This is the criticism that's all over. Every organization.
I know, but how does anybody know? You can't stand on a street corner in the biggest cities of Iran and saying, I'm from the BBC, I'm doing an opinion poll. How do you feel about the PMOI? Because you get your collar felt at least, and before you know where you are, you're in Irvin jail. So you can't do that.
Yes. Okay.
And it's dangerous to come out and say it anyway.
But do we see any signs that the Iranian people are supporting Mujahideen?
Do I see any signs?
Yeah.
Well, I'm not the man to ask about this. You should ask the mullahs.
Because you support them?
Well, hold on. You should ask the mullahs. They spend enormous amounts of money bad-mouthing the PMI and the Iranian resistance around the world and attempting to get members of the House of Commons and members of the House of Lords to change their minds about the resistance. Robert Fisk, the distinguished Middle East correspondent of The Independent, The Observer, no friend of the Iranian resistance, by the way, was invited by the mullahs to... They have a great sense of humour, the mullahs. Earlier this month, they promoted a counter-terrorism conference in Tehran. This is the one government in the world that spends more money aiding terrorist groups, Hamas, Hezbollah, interfering, training people, responsible for killing 7 out of every 10 coalition troops in Iraq, because they not only trained the people in using the weapons, they bought the weapons, they paid them to take them there, and they paid them to use them. And they sponsor this terrorism conference. Now, what's one of the biggest signs outside the conference? A photograph of Mrs. Rajavi, the president-elect of the National Council of Resistance of Iran. She's a terrorist, this woman. The mind boggles. So, they obviously think that the PMI has got support inside Iran. Otherwise, why waste money on this?
I mean, this is not indications of the Mujahideen being supported by the Iranian people. But the Americans also consider the Mujahideen as a terrorist organization. Well, the Europeans also consider them
No, just a minute. No, don't do that. Don't do that. 35 of us, of all parties, in 2007, took this government to court over their refusal to deprescribe the PMOI in this country. It was put on only as a favour by Jack Straw, which is admitted. As a favour, because the then Iranian foreign minister said, we want these people banned unless we're not going to talk to you about our nuclear weapons development. Well, and that's why that was...
I interviewed Mr. Straw and he rejected that...
Well, I've got a piece about where he admits it on the Today programme. He asked me to do it and I did it, so I did it. And those are almost his exact words. Because he had no evidence of this. We went to the Prescribed Organisations Appeal Commission, which is a branch of the High Court, who said... There was no evidence at all that since 2001, this organisation was in any way active in preparing for terrorism, planning to prepare for terrorism. There was just no evidence at all. It went to the appeal court, and the appeal court rubbed the government's noses in it again and said, you've got no evidence for this. This is not an organisation concerned with terrorism. So, the Americans now have been ordered by a court in Washington to review their prescription of the PMOI. And I can tell you this, because there's only you and I listening to this. they have exactly the same evidence as before our courts, because we share intelligence, as you will know. So if they decide not to deprescribe, it'll be for other reasons, which I can't guess at, because they know Iran's involvement in terrorism.
But you can't,
right around the Middle East.
Can, look, Robert, you can't regard the American government as a friend of Iranians, Iranian government.
Well, this is what surprises me, because on the one hand, they've got the...
So there must be something.
No, hold on. No, there's nothing there. And the appeal court went out of its way, the Prescribed Organizations Appeal Commission went out of its way to say, and even after examining the closed evidence, that is the security evidence, we still find no justification for this, for keeping on these people on the prescribed list. No, the Americans have got both the Revolutionary Guard and the PMI on the prescribed list. Now, that strikes me as schizophrenia. But the damage to this, and it's why people in Iran sometimes feel very alone in their desire for democratic change in that country, that the mullahs use this argument about the Americans to murder people in Camp Ashraf in Iraq. The Americans have got them on the terrorists. We think they're terrorists as well. Let's get rid of them.
Yeah, but it's not only the Americans. I mean, recently the report by the Australian government also saying that the PMOI is not an alternative, democratic alternative.
What's it got to do with the Australians?
No,
it's Iranian people who decide.
It's the Mujahideen who are spending huge sums of money lobbying all over the world. The congressmen, the MPs
it's
from
not for Australia
different countries.
To decide this. It's for the people of Iran to decide this. What all this is about. Mm-hmm. As Mrs. Rajavi made clear in a gathering of 100,000 Iranians in Paris last month, was she wants that organization to prepare the ground for the Iranian people to have the opportunity in free, democratic, UN-supervised elections to make a choice about what kind of government they want. That organization and others want a secular state with a respect for freedom, human rights, and an end to the nuclear weapons.
So then why do you think, Lord Corbett, that the organization with that Islamic ideology bring about some sort of a secular government in Iran?
Why not?
Well,
Turkey's done it. Why can't Iran? Turkey is a...
Well, they didn't bring about, they inherited a secular government.
Oh, excuse me, they were thrown out of government by the military at one stage for saying
Turkey was a secular state,
but I'm saying,
which they won an election and inherited
what
that
I'm
state.
What I'm saying is a majority Muslim population which votes for a Muslim government in a secular state can achieve this. Turkey is the best example of this and a good example of it. Why can't Iran?
Because it's
my case.
Yeah.
In any event, what the mullahs are doing in Iran is a perversion of Islam. They're perverting Islam, using it for their own ends.
No, but there are many people inside Iran who are, they call the religious intellectuals who are opposing the Iranian government's version of Islam, yeah, and all that. It's not just Mujahideen. The other criticism that is directed towards the Mujahideen is that this organization is not a democratic organization within itself. The members have no voice and is dictated by the leadership and Mr. Rajavi himself.
I hear those things said. This is a matter of... I'm not involved in the organization of the PMRI and the NCRI at all. It's up to them the way they do this. I'm interested in them because they want...
But, Lord Corbett,
they want what I want. They want a free, secular Iran.
It's if an organization which is not democratic and suppresses their members and they have no voice and saying that we are going to establish a secular democratic government, and you believe them?
Yes, I'm saying they want to help establish a secular democratic government in Iran.
So how do you know that they're helping? How do you know that they end up under the dictatorship?
Are you saying those 3,400 members of the PMI, they're less now because 57 have been slaughtered by Iraqis at Iran's orders? Are you saying that those in Ashraf have no say in what goes on in that camp? Rubbish. Absolute rubbish.
Well, this is the criticism I'm not saying. I'm just...
No, well,
I have gathered all sorts of criticism that is directed towards the Mujahideen and...
A delegation from the Union Parliament went there two years ago specifically to look into these allegations, and they found no evidence at all. Now, they interviewed PMI members one by one in
Who
cases.
Who are the delegations?
There's an all-party delegation from the European Parliament. I've forgotten that.
Independent?
Well, they're all party.
Yeah.
It doesn't make, I mean, I suppose it does make them.
Do they support the National Council of Resistance?
Some did, some don't. Some didn't.
So they weren't independent?
Yeah.
They weren't?
Well, they were. Some did, some didn't. Mm. They went there to find out the truth of this matter and came back and found no.
But it's like Human Rights Watch,
nobody can leave Ashraf.
The Human Rights Watch in 2005 suggested otherwise.
Well, that was a tainted report because I wrote to Human Rights Watch. I was very interested to find out from them. I got no response at all from them. How did you select the people to be interviewed? Who paid for the interpreters? How did you check on what they were saying? Did you check what they were, the allegations they were making were true as far as you could establish them, or did you take their word? Did you pay them for these interviews? So on and so on. Questions that anybody who wanted to try and understand the veracity of this report were entitled to get answers. I got no report at all. I must say I've had huge respect for Human Rights Watch up until then. And it just went right out of the window because they clearly couldn't defend what they'd done to produce that report. And I have reasons to believe that there was interference in that report on behalf of the Ministry of Intelligence and Security in Tehran. They got at them, in other words.
So one other reason that the people who are critical of Mujahideen saying that this organization is not a democratic organization is that whoever criticizes this organization in the slightest way, immediately they are regarded by the organization as the agents of Iranian government.
I don't know about it. I mean, I've heard the allegations. They're allegations which I think you'll find begin life in the Ministry of Intelligence and Security in Tehran. They'll do anything to badmouth the resistance because they don't like them, and that's fine,
What I'm saying, though, Robert, is that the Mujahideen organization basically accuses whoever criticizes them as agents of the Iranian government.
And sometimes they're right.
Well, how do they know?
Because I did a report here on Iran's agents in the United
they have
Kingdom.
Accused people who have been tortured by the Iranian government, who are in exile because of the Iranian government.
I know.
So who can they be the agent of the Iranian government?
I don't know, is the answer. And I'm not that bothered about it, to tell you the truth, because these are... I've got evidence of people operating here on behalf of the Iranian government. I've also got evidence of people who were in Ashraf, went back to Iran, and were then seen by the Ministry of Intelligence and Security saying, you can help us against this organization because we want you to make these allegations against
us. Well, I'm sure there may be. There may be.
I understand why that's done.
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
I understand that.
OK, we haven't got much time, Lord Corbett. Let's deal with Ashraf camp.
Yep.
In 2009, in August, when they were attacked by the Iraqi government.
July.
In July, sorry. And in August, basically, you, in front of the American embassy, you spoke there and you addressed Obama and also David Miliband, who was the foreign secretary at the time, yep, that you should adhere to your commitment to Ashraf. And then nothing happened. And recently, 2 years later, we have the same scenario repeating.
Yep.
Do you think that the leadership of Mujahideen is there also have responsibilities of removing people?
How can they have responsibility? They are there as refugees. I don't care whether they're Martians or members of the Iranian resistance, right? Iraq has given undertakings to the Americans before they withdrew their protection of those at Ashraf in 2009. They gave written undertakings that would guarantee their safety and security. They've been there twice. They've murdered, in cold blood, 57 residents, injured more than 1,000. The dead are still not buried from that last raid in April. There are people still dying from injuries caused in that raid in April because the Iraqis have denied them access to the medical facilities they want. That is a breach of international humanitarian law. And I can tell you now, if you don't know, that a Spanish magistrate is drawing up charges of war crimes against those, and we've got the names of them, those involved in the Iraqi military in carrying out that attack on the camp. These are war crimes in anybody's book. And Iraq, and hopefully we can get some Iranians involved in this, they should end up in The Hague and be put on trial for it. There is no license to murder people in cold blood for whatever reason.
Absolutely, Lord Corbett.
And the Americans are walking away from this. They have responsibilities. They gave them all in 2003, 2004, protected person's status under the Fourth Geneva Convention. American security forces interviewed them all individually, gave them these cards. Now, under that protection, the Americans are still responsible until the future of those at Ashraf is settled, which it is not. And we're now trying to persuade Mrs. Clinton and others that the Americans should go to the United Nations Council, volunteer to be a security force stationed in Camp Ashraf to stop the Iraqis and the Iranians mounting further attacks. Because if that is not done, there will be another Srebrenica-style massacre, because the Iraqi government, Maliki getting his orders from Tehran, have said they're going to wipe that camp off the face of the earth by the end of this year, whatever force is needed. And we are going to stand by and watch this happen, are we? I hope not.
All right. Thank you very much, Lord Corbett, for being the guest of the Thank you very much.